Beautifully sung. I love it.
Welcome everyone to this new episode of Success Stories of Expat Women. They did it, so can you. My name is Eva Saunders, and I'm an inspirational singer and songwriter, and I'm also an empowerment coach for women. Last 2 years, I worked mainly online, one-on-one, and honestly, I miss so much in-person contact that I definitely plan to create much more in-person events and also group events, because I do believe when we gather together, we can really brainstorm, support each other, and really bring amazing insights, inspiration, and results for everyone. So stay in tune so you can discover what will come next. I am also very grateful to introduce our today guest, Keren-Jo. Hi, Keren-Jo.
Hi. Thank you for inviting me. I don't know what to expect, but
we are gonna discover your life journey so we can see how it can be helpful for us. I'm sure we will discover a lot of inspiring things. So let us start at the beginning. Where are you from originally? What brought you to Switzerland? How long have you been there? And where are you exactly?
So I arrived in, well, let's say I arrived in France in 2008, 2007. Just to go back a little bit, my profession has always been in banking. Mm-hmm. So actually prior to that, I'd taken sort of 18 months. It was going to be a 6 month sabbatical. I worked in business banking and the wealth management side. So I took a break, a sabbatical. And it was only meant to be for 6 months, but I was having such a wonderful time that it turned into 18 months. So I came back, in 2006, 2007.
And you say you came to France. Was it like close to the border with Switzerland, or was it another?
Exactly, yes. It was, as people, if they know the French side, the Chamonix, Saint-Gervais, yes. So yes, on my travels, before I actually went back to work, I met a Frenchman in France, and we had a long distance relationship for 1 year.
Wow.
And then I decided to move to Switzerland. That's the short story of it, to work in Switzerland and to live in France. So that's a little bit of background in terms of how I ended up being in Switzerland.
Are you still frontalier? Are you still close to the?
No. Now, 4 years ago, I moved to Zug, to the German speaking side. So now I'm not a frontalier, but I know all about frontaliers.
And the challenges we have. Are you originally? Where are you from?
So I'm from the UK. It's always difficult to answer this question because I moved around a lot. I was born in the Midlands, in just outside of Birmingham, Staffordshire, and I was raised in the north, and then I left at 18, back to the Midlands, worked in London. So I had a 15-year career with HSBC. So it was very interesting. It seems like another life ago. It was another life ago. So yeah, and then I moved. So
that was when you first moved to France, close to Switzerland. How did you go about finding a job in the banking world? How did
you? Let's say these things, when we make changes in our life, it's normally something that's been difficult. So when I came back from traveling, I lost my mother was diagnosed with terminal cancer.
Oh.
So I spent the next six months with her. And then it just gave me a chance to reevaluate, you know, what you want in life. And
yes.
Yeah, so my partner has said there's much more beautiful places to live. why don't you come and live? He had a 18-month-old son, so I became an instant mother to him. So I had a package. And he had, he has moderate to learning difficulties. So it was a big challenge, but also it was what I needed, a new fresh start. So I had no job to go to. I just decided that I was going to move and I would find a job.
Okay. Wow. And what I feel is there was this huge transition for you. Very often when you go through something difficult, pain, yeah, it's a really of moment like going inside ourselves. It's not comfortable, but yet it can really bring from us the best of us. I mean,
yeah,
we go closer to who we truly are and what we were meant to do here.
Yeah,
in some way. Was it your experience?
Yeah, absolutely. So I took the sabbatical from my bank because you could call me a bit of a workaholic at that time. So I wanted to take that time out to just reassess that, you know, I've always found, well, for me, the most important is to love what you're doing, to have a joy about it. Life's too short to do things that you don't enjoy.
Absolutely.
So for me, it was a good step to take back. I've always been interested in health. I trained as a ballet dancer, so I took my yoga teacher training during that time. I studied Ayurveda in India, so I wanted to focus on myself and just to open myself up to more
exploring,
because a lot of my colleagues at the bank had said that it would be 10 years till retirement. I don't want that to be my life, my pattern, because, I've worked hard, don't get me wrong, but I just thought it's good sometimes just to reassess every now and again that you're on the right path, that you're doing what gives you joy. And I just felt I was working too hard. So that's why I took the step back. And then, of course, when I came back from traveling, my mother not long was then diagnosed. So I put my plans behind and just thought, I want to spend that time with my mother and just make that precious time, and then I'll reassess afterwards. So it was good for me to say, okay, in an ideal world, we'd look for a job and then move, then make the transition. But sometimes we just have to go with our instinct.
Sometimes we have our plans, and then there is life happening, and we just
fast. Yeah, exactly.
And so what happened when you came close to Switzerland or France, and with all this experience, fresh experience, what happened? What did you do?
So I found a job relatively quickly. Mm-hmm. So I'm just going to turn that. I've got to call them through. I found a job pretty quickly. I'd went to HSBC in Switzerland, and they said yes. But unless you've got a net worth of 5 million plus, then we're not interested. So that was a big change for me. So I decided to work independently and set up my own business through an agency. So I worked for a company for a short period of time, but it was very different, let's put it that way. It was, for me, it was like going back in time 20 years ago in terms of women and men. Mm-hmm. The first interview that I went for, they said, how do you think they'll feel, a woman telling them what to do with the money, and teaching tactics to say, if a man says, I need to speak to my wife, you say, who wears the trousers? So it was like a new world coming to me.
How did you deal with this gap, cultural gap?
I found it quite funny, but then I just found it as like an opportunity and just thought, well, if these people are not being looked after, then, there's a huge gap there. So for me, I saw it as an opportunity rather than an issue. It was the beginning of my career. I was so lucky to have some great mentors that supported women, that found that, having a diverse workforce is better. So for me, it was like, even in the it was the early 90s I started working, so there was still, it was right at the beginning then, for women to be working. So I found that refreshing. I was, like I say, I was fortunate to work with some great bosses, and it was a big cultural shock coming to Switzerland with that view.
Yes.
But yeah, it just made me more determined to work on that.
I love this. I love this because you have this very natural, positive approach. Like, it's not an issue, it's an opportunity.
Yeah.
You see it as an opportunity, and this is called mindset. We can see something as a problem or setback or pain or whatever.
Yeah.
We can see it as an opportunity to grow, to adjust, to see what's behind.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
How long did you remain there, and how was this experience?
I stayed there for 4 months. It didn't, for me, I know one thing for me, I'm always in alignment with my values, and if they're not being met, so it's that for me is
okay.
I have to be true to that. So it wasn't in alignment with my values, but I learned a lot, and I'm grateful for that.
Would you like to share some of your values with us? It's really important, because when we know ourselves, when we know what's right for us, when we know our values, we can really go where our values are honored, and where we feel respected, and when we can give our best.
Yeah.
So that's so important. Would you like to name some of your values?
Yeah, for me, it's about doing the right thing. So in wealth management, helping people with their money is a position of trust.
Mm-hmm.
And that takes time, so I've always focused on building relationships and I had that freedom in the bank at that time. They saw that I did the right thing, rather than you've got a target of this, I know it's like you need to sell this. For me, it's not about selling, it's about identifying needs. So when you're genuine and you come from that perspective, then for me, money flows, energy is money. So I was never focused on the selling, and maybe that's a female aspect, I don't know. I've always been told I spend time with clients, but I've always achieved, if you do the right thing, things come. So in this particular environment, it was like being in an environment with, when it comes to money, it's a lot of egos, and it just wasn't my way. So I like to take the approach and get to know my clients and understand what's important to them. So I add a different layering in terms of what's important for you in life, what gives you joy, because money is an aim to, it helps us, it gives us choice, but it doesn't create happiness. I've worked with, in the UK, I worked in business banking. So people with money, they just spend their time working like I did, and we forget to enjoy the life may not be here tomorrow. So for me, that's always enjoy today, because tomorrow may not be here. So my values are always about integrity and doing the right thing, and if I don't feel those are matched, or then I will remove myself from the situation. And I've done a few times.
So let us go ahead. What happened after these 4 very instructive months?
So I joined another company.
What's really interesting for our audience is, how did you go about this change? How did you network? Did you send CVs? How did you find new opportunities?
Yeah, I mean, I love collaborating with people and network. So there's not everybody knows everybody. And I got approached from different companies to join them. So my challenge was to try and feel as much, understanding as possible of the right value for me, the right set. So that's really important in terms of understanding how people work. But, the lessons I've learned is we can never really know people. We just have to do the right thing ourselves.
Okay, so you joined another company, have you and did you stay longer there?
That was 8 years. That was 8 years. So I built up a client base. Again, I've worked with women. There's a lot of great women that are the main earners in families. If I dealt with the guys in the family, then I would always want to involve the wife because I think it's great in terms of relationships that we share that. So my challenge, I've seen a lot.
You contribute to educate women on,
yes.
on money. To, yeah. That's amazing. Yeah. It's so just needed. It's amazing.
Yeah. For me, the most important is it's not about knowing everything right now. It's just get involved. And we learn as we go along. We don't know everything. I don't know everything. So
yeah.
We learn as we go along and not to be afraid. But yeah, it would be many women, if they don't understand things, they want to know a bit more in detail, whereas, you know, the model that's still used today, even 30 years later, is it's from a male perspective. Women have different ways of thinking about things, understanding things. So it was about, I'm probably jumping ahead, but 2 years ago I left and focused on women, financial planning for women, because I just found a lot of my friends at my age were going through divorces, ending up in difficult situations, yes. financially. So it's more about, let's get rid of these traditional roles. You do this. We're all responsible for ourselves. And it takes away a lot of worry by getting involved in taking control of your own financial situation.
Yes. That should be a part of our education from the beginning. I do.
Yes, I know.
Taking
yeah.
responsibility for ourselves. I mean, this yeah. period where we were taught to marry a rich man is
yes.
over. It's over. And it's not healthy anyway, because you don't know when the rich man can leave you.
Exactly.
So
it's funny, actually.
It's so much healthier when we learn to, from the beginning, to take responsibility
yeah.
for ourselves.
Yeah, it's funny you say that. My brother just visited with my nieces. They're 7 and 10. And, you know, they're starting to understand about money. You know, why does Auntie Jenny have such a big house compared to our house? And then my brother said, you need to marry a builder. And I said, hang on a minute. You can do this yourself. So it's those are very old fashioned beliefs that you marry a good man and will be, you know, responsible. You know, then you won't have to worry. We've got everything in our own hands to create a life that's important. If we meet a partner, great, we can share that with you. But I think it's important to teach that at a very early age. And I'm quite encouraged that now there's a lot more investment into educating educating children. There's movement there and educating women, and so we're all on an equal playing field, so to speak.
Absolutely.
I mean, in my relationship with just to say with the French guy I met and his son, he had a business, but we decided in the end that it would be me that would be working for our family balance. So it doesn't matter about in terms of dynamics, but it's difficult in Switzerland for women, for families in general, to have both be working, because it doesn't really support it, the system. Yes. For expats, if you're a local Swiss person here, then yes, you have family here, but it's very difficult to do that.
Absolutely.
So that's why I say get involved, you know, even if you're not working but have some passion that's outside of the family, do that. Because I have so many women say to me, you know, when it goes wrong, I did this, I gave up my life. No, talk about money, because it's really important for
absolutely.
Healthy relationships and for you as a person.
Absolutely. Thank you for this contribution. Okay, tell me, where are you today? So you said you moved to Zug, you're in Zug now.
Yes. So yeah, my, you know, for me, it was like, where do I start again? Because I walked away from my last company.
Mm-hmm.
So it was a chance to recreate what I wanted to do myself. Because although I worked for an agency, they still want you to perform the way they want to do. So I wanted to do it my way.
Well, not totally free.
Hmm. Yeah, exactly. I wasn't totally free. Now I am free to do what I want. So there's so many areas.
Tell us, what do you do? What do you do? I'm just so curious to know.
Yes. So I'm a financial and life planner. So first of all, I look at the life planning of our site. As I say, sometimes we can just get caught in a rut racing families, just going along existing and not living a life that we should be living. So I start with some very powerful questions, mm-hmm. Which is, you know, first of all, you've got 10 years left to live. If you knew you only had 10 years left to live, how would you live that? Would you make any changes? Because life is precious. And then I go a step further and say, imagine now you've only got 5 years left to live.
Yeah.
What would you do? How would you change your life? What have you not done? What would you do differently?
Mm.
And then a horrible question to ask, but you know, you have one day to live.
Mm. Yeah.
What did you regret? You know, what didn't you get to do? Who did you not get to be? Because regrets are normally what we didn't do, not what we have done. So that for me is a big question for people to sort of think about the life, where do they want to be? Because none of us know. And one thing I know in working in my profession is that we can't think further than 12 months, never 5 years, never 10 years. Life is fluid, life changes. But if we have a vision and view, we've got more chance of achieving that than let's just exist and carry on doing what we're doing.
Mm.
So the life planning is a big part. Then I look at the financial planning. So, you know, what is your lifestyle? So I find people either have too much money and still continue doing what they're doing because maybe they have a lack of scarcity, or they have enough and they don't know it and they're still working. And then there's those that don't have enough and still have an extravagant lifestyle that they will not be able to, if they continue doing what they're doing, they won't be able to maintain that standard of life. So I look at, first of all, look at, you know, what are you spending your money on? Where is that going?
Yes.
And then, you know, that could be, yeah, I had that same realization in my 30s when I left for Australia, looking at all the wardrobe of clothes that I hadn't worn, that I've just bought. You know, we waste a lot of money.
Yes.
So,
yes.
You know, what's important to you in life? Absolutely. For me, the most important are experiences rather than things that give us pleasure for a moment. So that's one part I look at as well in terms of, you know, what lifestyle do you want?
Yes.
You know, some people live modest lifestyles and that's great. And that's one of my, my goal is to live as modestly as possible. I don't want to be reliant on money. It doesn't give you your happiness, but I love to travel. That's my joy. So I want to continue to be doing that.
Yes.
And living in the moment now as well. So,
yeah, so
I'm focused on helping women with the financial planning and then looking at solutions if they're appropriate. So that's my first step. I'm also looking to expand that in terms of maybe looking at educational. I've been asked to do educational programs at schools.
So do you work like one-on-one or are there...
I work one-on-one, but, you know, money is a one-on-one subject. Yeah. But in terms of educational, it would have to be generic.
Well, there could be a class or training, you know, like for groups also.
Yeah.
It would be interesting. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So what women who come to see you and what challenges are they are they facing and how your coaching can transform their challenges into solutions or results or whatever?
Yeah. So I have women of all ages. So I have those that are coming up to retirement, but looking at the transition, do they stay in Switzerland or, you know, do they want to move to their family? But again, if we've been in Switzerland a long time, that's a big transition to move to another country. Do we have enough money? Because obviously Switzerland's a very expensive place to, mm-hmm. to look. But it's planning for that because retirement is a big... So it's different events that women will come to me for. The retirement is one part. Women go through divorce that have not dealt with the finances before.
Mm-hmm.
That's a huge challenge. So again, I do the financial planning, but it could be a bigger project in terms of helping unravel finances and helping them learn and understand different investments and and how they should do that. And then I have the younger generation in terms of planning for families and how they navigate through that. It's funny, actually, I have the younger generation say, we don't want to be in a situation that the old, your generation are in, where we've got no money. So I want to plan for that and keep it separately. So I see a change in the younger generation, which I'm really encouraged by. It's two diversities.
Yeah.
In terms of the spend culture, the buy, they're mindful, they don't want to spend money on buying clothes, they'll buy charity clothes, which I think is great. So everybody's in different mindsets. So the female clients are all different life stages. So I'm there to help through the different stages of life.
If there is any woman in the audience that is interested, how can she get in touch with you?
So I will drop the link to you on my website, KerenJoThomas.com. I also write a blog, which also helps in terms of explaining a little bit about me and what's important. So I also provide some tools to do some planning for how you're spending your money, where your money goes. So making money, every cent count towards whether it's putting money away for the future or for those trips that give you joy or investing in yourself, for if you want to start that business. So many different things. So yeah, they can contact me via my website.
Amazing. Yes, I'll drop your website to the introduction so everyone who is interested can get in touch with you. Okay, thank you, Keren, for all sharing your journey, your insights, your wisdom. I just love, actually, you're working with money, which is very down to earth and real. It can be very scary for a lot of us. And at the same time, you go further than just money by asking questions. What's the most important for you? So it's not only money, but it's the money in a larger context of my life and of my values and of who I am and what I want to create here in this precious time, as you said.
Yeah, exactly.
Earth.
I mean, just going a little bit further, I'm working with Alana Money Coaching, because there's a lot of great women out there in my space, in the finance space, where they're educating women. We have money traumas, again, from our childhood in terms of how we treat money. So it goes much more deeper than that. But again, if you're not getting involved in the finances, my message would be, please do. And just small steps, just get involved, try to understand it, or reach out, to me. We can have a clarity call.
It's the path to empowerment and freedom. We cannot be free if we don't manage our money, if we don't control our money, it's not possible. So for me, it's a path to freedom and to empowerment.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Financial freedom. There's a blog that I've written about financial freedom and wellness.
Yes.
We spend a lot of time worrying about money, and that's for me, that's
useless.
Wasting time. Wasting time, you could be doing something else. And I know I'm going to be okay. Of course, we don't know what's ahead of us in the future, but by having a structure, we can let go of those worries and focus on enjoying today.
Absolutely. Yeah. Thank you, Keren. I have the last one question. What would you suggest to these women who moved recently to Switzerland, who are discovering it's pretty hard, it's tough to start there on personal level, on professional level, creating social circle and so on. What would you suggest to these women who are struggling today? Recently in Switzerland, what would you suggest them?
Well, as my seven-year-old niece said to me yesterday, she said she wants to help people to never give up. That's what I would say, is to not give up, because I won't pretend my journey was easy. It hasn't been easy, the journey. But if we take those little steps each day to get out of our comfort zone, to get involved, get a network of people. There's some great networks in Switzerland. The Women Rock Switzerland is a great platform. get involved, look at the local areas that you may be living in, and we understand, you know, the expat women, we understand it's a challenge. So people are more welcome and understanding. So never give up, take each day as it comes, and every step is progress. So that would be my my message. And get involved in the finances.
Don't run away anymore. Just pay some fees and get involved. Absolutely. Yeah.
The amount of women that say when we talk about money, it's like the shutters come down. I'm like that with IT. But it's just one little step each time we just develop, we get involved in it. And you're doing actually more than what you do. I mean, women say they get involved in the household budget. That's a small part, but that's a very important part. So one step at a time.
Definitely. Well, thank you very much, Keren-Jo. I'm so grateful I invited you.
Yeah, thank you.
I didn't realize what a treasure I invited you today to our series. I'm so grateful. Thank you for opening this very taboo.
Yeah, subject. Yes, it is. Yes, yeah. And talk about money. Talk about money.
Talk about money. Absolutely.
Yeah. It's not bad.
It's not bad.
Income.
It's a part of your freedom and empowerment.
Yeah.
Thank you very much. I'm looking forward to meeting you again in person.
Yeah, likewise. Yeah, likewise.
Thank you for what you are doing in empowering and empowering other women. I wish you
yes, well. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Okay, thanks, Ada, for inviting me. Bye.
And remember, you were born to thrive.
I love that. I love it.
Even for your money.
I find that I'm singing it to myself, but it's very, very catchy.
Thank you.